Coming through the computer today. So, okay. Let's try this.
Right from here. Let's see what kind of buzz we get.
Maybe the buzz won't be too bad. Let me open up the stream on my phone and hear it. Thank you.
pick up your chair.
Yeah, I don't want
to. Oh, sorry. No, you're fine. It's just this isn't getting noise either, is it?
Uh-huh.
It's not getting noise either.
I disconnected this.
Okay, okay.
So the only thing that's coming right now
is that. Why is it not connected? Be very nice. It's just not recognizing it as a device. Recognized it when it was connected to that.
Did you say it did recognize it?
Yeah, it recognized it when it was connected by that.
Let me send you a little box.
It's something to do with the network. The camera will not connect to the website it goes through. So I have to do it through the third-party streaming service, and third-party streaming service is not connected to this whatsoever, so I can't get any audio from it.
Thank you.
ever rendered. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you doing this? Say, the Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly. They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, what are you doing untying that colt? They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jerusalem to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Thank you.
Please be seated. We'd ask that you take a moment to fill the yellow slips that are in the basket on the table. This allows us to know that you've been with us and to give thanks for your presence. And if you have a prayer request, there are orange cards in there that you can fill out and go in the collection offering place, and we will remember your prayer concerns and our prayers. Following worship, we will feel today and have some snacks and welcome call afterwards. Today is your last chance to order flowers to decorate our building for Easter. The form is in today's bulletin, where you can order or even pay online. Look for the Easter flower article on fpcebb.com. We will come together to worship for Monday, Thursday, as we did last year, which will be a simple meal of soup and bread here at Fellowship Hall. And we will have the Monday, Thursday service here. Include foot washing, Vanders Ease is staying in worship, and communion. And then afterwards, we will move over to the sanctuary to finish the service, the tenebrae service over in the sanctuary. So I hope that all of you will be able to join us for this evening of fellowship and worship on our Monday service for this Holy Week. As part of our offering today, we received a 1 great hour of sharing and offering. You have heard about the 75-year effort throughout the Lenten season. You may use the envelope in your bulletin to join Presbyterians around the world in providing relief from natural disasters, food for the hungry, and support for the poor and oppressed. So give generously to that. You can stay up to date on all the news and events of the congregation by reading the announcements. We're very glad you're here in person and online. Now let's continue our worship.
It was pointed out to me that my prayer of confession was not the same one you had, so sorry about that. Hope the rest of it looks fine. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, source of all life, we hear again the story of compassion. Let the same mind be in us that was in Christ, who was a servant that we might be free. Awaken our ears, open our hearts, and sustain the weary with your word. Amen. Please join me in reading from Psalm 31. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly. For my life is wasted. My ears are silent. My strength fails me because of affliction, and my bones are consumed. I have become a reproach to all my enemies, and even to my neighbors, a dismay to those of my acquaintance. When they see me in the street, they avoid me.
I have forgotten my course, I will not. I am useless and broken in heart.
For I have heard the whispering of the crowd. Fear is all around. Put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life.
But as for me, I trust in you, O Lord. I have said, you are my God.
My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hands of my enemies and from those who persecute me.
May your face shine upon my servant, and in the middle of my time to save me.
Today's lesson from the book of Mark continues the events of Holy Week. Now the Passover and the Festival of Unleavened Bread were only 2 days away, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were scheming to arrest Jesus secretly and kill him. But not during the festival, they said, or the people may riot. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. Some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, "Why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and the money given to the poor." And they rebuked her harshly. "Leave her alone," said Jesus. "Why are you bothering her? She's done a beautiful thing to me. Poor you will always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want, but you will not always have me. She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand, there for my burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priests to betray Jesus to them. When evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at the table eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They were saddened, and one by one they said to him, "Surely you don't mean me." "It is one of the 12," he replied, "one who dips bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to the man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. "Truly I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God." When they had summoned him, they went out to the Mount of Olives. "You will all fall away," Jesus told them, "for it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will scatter. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." Peter declared, "Even if all fall away, I will not." "Truly I tell you," Jesus answered, "today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me 3 times. But Peter insisted emphatically, "Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you." And all the others said the same.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death," he said to them. "Stay here and keep watch." Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Simon," he said to Peter, "are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Once more he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the 3rd time, he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." Just as he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, appeared. With him was a crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal to them. "One I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. The men seized Jesus and arrested him. And one of those standing near drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Am I leading a rebellion," Jesus said, "that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me?" While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she looked closely at him. "You also were with him, that Nazarene, Jesus," she said, but he denied it. "I don't know or understand what you're talking about," he said, and went out into the entryway. When the servant girl saw him there, she said again to those standing around, "This fellow is one of them." Again, he denied it. After a little while, those standing there to Peter, "Surely you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." He began to call them palm branches. And if you were at the second service, you would see everyone gathered out front waving their palm branches as we paraded into the sanctuary. We have robust music calling us to worship, remembering Christ's return to Jerusalem as he wholeheartedly embraced by his followers the shouts of Hosanna. Our reading this morning from Mark is not the traditional story that we think about when we think about Palm Sunday. It's rather long and goes through the whole of Christ's arrest and Peter's denial. There is no reading here of happy people welcoming Jesus with love. After the last 5 Sundays of me preaching on our need to reflect, repent, seek forgiveness, and humble ourselves before God, I'm sure you were all eagerly awaiting for a happy sermon. But that's not going to happen today. But there is happiness at the end, rather wonderful, uplifting message at the end. But first, I'd like us to think about the difficulty and torment that Jesus was entering into. We think of the happy people that are there to welcome him, to worship him as he rises to Jerusalem. But what he was really riding into was a week of disappointment with his disciples, a week of pain and torture, a week of agony, questioning God, why do I have to go through this? And ultimately ending the week with his crucifixion. I'd like us this morning to think of these themes of betrayal, denial, and abandonment so that we can learn from these early disciples. First, betrayal. We know that Judas, who betrayed Jesus, was the one who betrayed Jesus, but we are never told why. What we do know about him is that he, like the other disciples, gave 3 years of his life to follow Jesus. He left behind family, his job, everything that was comfortable and familiar to him. What led Judas and the others to give up everything? Follow Jesus. He, just like the other disciples, saw something in Jesus that led him to leave everything behind and to follow him. We know that Judas betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. We're not told by any of the gospel writers why he did so, but let us look about what we do know. We know that no one in this tight group of 12 disciples suspected that he would be the one to betray Jesus. We just heard that at the Last Supper, when Jesus said that one of them would betray him, that all the disciples asked, who? Is it me? Could it be me? None of them thought that it would be Judas. Judas had never shown any signs of rebelliousness or traitorous behavior that would have caused them to think of him. Perhaps in the beginning he had believed Messiah talk, the thought that it meant an earthly kingdom that Jesus was going to establish, and that he wanted to be near the seat of power. But whatever he thought, he didn't truly grasp what Jesus had been saying over those 3 years, and the sacrifice of what it meant to be a follower of Jesus. What he probably didn't anticipate when he betrayed Jesus was that Jesus would be put to death. Religious disputes wouldn't have caused a death penalty to happen. He probably was shocked to learn about the religious leaders turning him over to the Roman authorities and all that happened next. Well, we know what happens to the rest of the story of Judas. But how does this story relate to us today? We need to consider carefully our motivation. Are our motivations tainted in some way? Judas's motivations were tainted. It seemed he wanted to be there close to power, and that's what he thought was going to happen. But when it didn't happen, he betrayed him. We need to ask ourselves what our motivation is when facing new situations, with challenging situations. Do we have selfish motivations that are hiding within us that we need to root out? And we need to consider what will happen in the end. we make the choice in that decision, whether it will lead to something good for God, or is it only ourselves we are thinking about? Eugene Peterson wrote in his book, Letters to a Young Pastor, that everything Satan offered Jesus in the wilderness looked good, but it conflicted with Jesus' goals. Similarly, what Satan offered Judas looked good to him, but in the end, it was terrible. As we walk with God, we need to seek God's help to have a long view. Is it good, or will it lead to something terrible? Second is denial. Peter denied Jesus 3 times, even though he told Jesus that he would never deny him. When it came down to it, fear took over, and he denied Jesus not once, but 3 times. We may think that we would never deny Jesus, but don't we at times? Peter denied Jesus when he found himself in a difficult situation and became afraid. He worried about his own safety, and in so doing demonstrated that he really didn't trust Jesus with his life and with his future. He wanted the easy way, the comfortable way. He didn't want to risk what would happen to him if he acknowledged Jesus. There was a threat there to his life if he did, and he wasn't willing to risk that. Don't we often do the same? Fail to acknowledge Jesus when we are in difficult or painful or stressful situations. We give in to our fear or anger, our resentments, our grudges, our grief, and let them take over our lives rather than acknowledging that Christ saved us. Instead of standing firm in faith that God can turn these feelings around, that God can make a good future for us despite the problems that pop up, we let that fear and anger take over and control our lives. This denial represents our inability to fully accept and believe in Jesus for who he is and what he does for us each and every day. We deny Jesus when we deny Jesus often in our lack of deep faith and trust in the miracle of Jesus' life on earth and the resurrection into new life. I always had my hospice patients remember those moments when they knew without a shadow of a doubt that Jesus was with them in their lives and had gotten them through a difficult situation. In that recalling, they found strength to get through the health challenges of that day and in facing their impending death. Our denial is our inability to accept fully and believe in Jesus for who he is. When we are able to see those moments of God's faithfulness to us, we draw strength and should always draw that strength when troubles come our way. Don't deny Jesus, but acknowledge him when life gets tough. And finally, abandonment. The disciples first slept and then fled when Jesus needed them most. Do we do that? Sleep when Jesus calls us to be awake and watch. Flee when we don't want to deal with the messiness of life. How do we see ways we abandon Jesus in modern day? For me, it brings me back to Matthew 25. We abandon Jesus when we ignore the stranger, when we don't try to welcome and bring into the fold those who are rejected in society, when we do nothing for the poor and the marginalized. Jesus says that inasmuch we do these things to these people, we do it unto him. But too often we abandon them in their struggle. Their struggle to eat, their struggle to get adequate housing, their struggle to get health care. Instead, they struggle, often dying young, because of those difficult lives they are forced to lead. And we abandon Jesus by not doing more to change the oppressive system that we all live under. There is a story that Alexander Schemerman told. He was a Greek Orthodox priest. He shared that when he was young and in love, before he became a priest, he got on a train in Paris with his girlfriend at the time. They were laughing and enjoying themselves when a very large, old, and very ugly woman boarded the train. In his native tongue of Russian, he and his girlfriend laughed at her ugliness. And when she got up to leave the train, she said to them in perfect Russian, "I didn't always look this way." That encounter brought a shock of revelation to him, as he saw the old woman as an angel, a reminder to him to see beyond appearances and embrace the divine presence in others. We abandon Jesus when we flee from the poor and destitute. Why else would we make sure that the poor live near industrial areas instead of being integrated in housing with the rest of us? We don't want to see. We deny the extent of the problems these people live with. We close our eyes to their suffering. And in so doing, we deny and we abandon Christ. We need to see the divine presence in each and every person so that we can see the angels that are all around us and accept the gifts that come through that. As we continue to reflect on the Passion of Jesus as we go through this final week, let us stay conscious of the ways that we betray, deny, and abandon the one whom we say we worship and follow. Let us remember that we follow Jesus not for what he can do for us, but for who he is. Let us remember we worship the living God, the resurrected Christ, through whom we live and have our being. Amen.
Thank you.
gave himself for the life of the world. With humble hearts, bowed in awe, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God.
Pray for all who are distressed, broken, or sorrowful. for your mercy to Israel. Loving God, we pray as only you can hear. Save us, O Lord, for your mercy is great. We ask all this in the name of Jesus, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, as we pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
So now, as you go out, may you hold that love.